Hi again, YouTube. It's Rebecca. I wanted to talk about what it's like to be a sociable person. Dissociative person has a lot of challenges in my life, and I've been pretty afraid to talk about it for a long time. The people who are very close to me in my life, they sort of understand enough to cope with it with me and know when to offer me space or comfort, but I kind of wanted to give an inside perspective on what that looks like from me, who's dealing with it. Part of having a post-traumatic stress is this symptom of dissociating, and that's sort of being not aware of your mind and body connection. And I'm not a doctor. I've just seen a lot of doctors and how it's been explained to me that, and when you have something and you don't feel like people who have medical degrees or whatever, they've gone to school to study this, and you don't feel like they're helping you, it's common that you go and you search it out yourself. So I've done a lot of reading, I've done a lot of research, and a lot of conversations have been had with previous therapy people and my current therapy people, and I feel like I've got sort of another way of explaining it firsthand. So what dissociation looks like for a normal person is you could be driving along on a highway or going to a destination just even a couple blocks from your home, and all of a sudden you don't remember your whole trip of getting there, how you got there, or you feel like all of a sudden you're in a familiar place again. And that's sort of a dissociation where your mind just goes on autopilot and you're just driving along. You don't really focus on anything else but getting where you're going. And then once you're there, you're like, wow, I forgot how I got here. So I have that. That's normal. I also have it at extreme levels. So for me, a dissociation looks like I'm here and I could be having a conversation with you, but I'm not here. I'm somewhere else. It's almost like, please leave a message after the beep. I'm not home right now, but I'll listen to your message later, sort of a thing. It helps me, like, I can do my job and I can be present when it's sort of routine. It's serious that I need to be present. But when I'm feeling threatened or something is threatening me, it may not even be in a normal like attack on my body or my mind, but if I just feel a little bit stressed out about something happening, I can choose to either forcefully keep present, and then I have to do a lot of calming techniques like breathing and grounding myself to my environment, where I focus on the things that I see and how I'm not going to leave. Dissociation could look like I am present and then all of a sudden I am blank, or I'm having a problem keeping up with a conversation. I'm forgetting parts of the conversation, even if somebody has just said to me something that I need to remember at the end of the conversation when they're like, okay, bye. I'm like, wait. And then I ask the same question they just answered. So a lot of my life, I've been told I just have a terrible memory, or, oh, Rebecca, you're just forgetful, or thinking that I've got some sort of ADHD attention deficit, something where I just can't sit still, I can't focus. But that's not true, because when I really want to focus, I can. And all throughout school, I felt like I was really good at my homework, I was good at reading, I was in advanced classes for like math and tag, reading, writing, all of that. So I don't think I have an attention deficit disorder. What I think I have is an inability to stay in my body, and instead I'm retreating out and I'm putting somebody else forward. And I also want to make sure I say that I don't feel like I've got multiple people inside of me. What I do feel like is I have the ability to just put my answering machine on. So I'm focused, I'm looking at somebody, but I'm not there. And it makes it really hard to get to know new people. It takes several times before I know who somebody is, and I constantly have to ask, who is this person? Who was that person that said this? I only get to pick up little pieces of a conversation from somebody enough to maybe possibly link them to a face. If I'm at a party, if I'm going to a new event and there's several people there, maybe more than, actually, it doesn't matter how many there are. There could be one person that's new, or it could be an entire room full of new people. I can respond if I'm prompted to, just because I know how to speak. You hear your name and you speak, but I'm not there. A good example is we went to an event and there were lots of new people going around the room and explaining who they are. And I could explain. I said, hi, I'm so-and-so. I'm from this town. And that was it. That's all I remember, because that was when I was prompted to come back. That was when I was prompted to give a response. When I'm not prompted to give a response, I am nowhere near the room that I'm in. I am somewhere else. I can't even remember where I go. But I've been doing it for so long that I've gotten really, really good at it. Also, when you learn to dissociate, I'm not exactly sure when I learned to do it, but very quietly, without any signals that I was leaving. So I'm present, I'm actively participating in whatever thing is happening, but I'm not there. And it's sort of like, I'm gonna leave so this doesn't hurt me. I'm gonna leave so I don't remember this. So I usually have memories that begin and then have long periods of blankness and then they end. Some of the things that trigger a dissociation just for me would be abrupt changes. If all of a sudden what I'm focused on needs to be different, I have a hard time staying present. And I'll give an example. If at work, I'll use an example from one of my first jobs. So I would be driving pizzas, and I would get a phone call that said that the person doesn't want the pizza, or I have to come back. For whatever reason, I'm not to deliver this particular pizza. I would have to pull over. Which streets I'm going to turn on, which roads, which signs I'm going to see, which landmarks I'm going to see. And if any of that changes, it just adds a little hiccup in my ability to stay present. So I get lost a lot. That pizza delivery job didn't last very long, thankfully, because it was also at night and very scary. But that's a different story. You can ask me about that later if you really care. Some of my dissociations come when I'm just doing monotonous tasks and my brain wanders. A lot of the time, I will be reminded of something that will trigger me. I'll have a thought about, oh, I'm doing dishes. And then it'll link up to a memory that'll link to another memory that'll end me up putting me in some dissociative place where I'm not there. And the best way I can describe how that works, how a flashback works, is sort of in the movie, if you all watch Harry Potter, I don't doubt everybody has probably seen it. Harry Potter has access to Dumbledore's cabinet where the Pensieve is. And in the Pensieve, there's all these vials of memories that Dumbledore has cast out. And I feel like when I'm having a traumatic event, I cast my memory out and I put it in a safe holding place and I forget about it. It's not in my mind. And the only way that I can go back and re-access that memory is either through other memories or going into a dissociation flashback. Unexpectedly, most likely. So, in the movie, Harry puts his face into the Pensieve and is immediately like pulled down into this memory and is not aware of anything else happening around him, to the point where people were walking into the room he was in and he wasn't there. He didn't recognize that they were there. So once the flashback is over, you feel like you've popped back out into reality and you don't know what's happening. So first things, you look around, make sure you're safe. Where are people? If there are people, what are they doing? What are you doing? That was my cat. What are you doing? What are the people doing? And if you can get away and be by yourself. So for me, if I'm having a hard time and I've just had a flashback and there's a lot of people around, I usually go and hide. And a lot of times that's not easy. So I've been known to hide in bathrooms. I've hidden in changing rooms, just anywhere where I can feel mostly solitary and just regroup. Because some of the memories that I flash back to, I haven't had since the actual time that I made the memory. So some of the things that cause me to have a flashback are these triggers. So I could have an emotional trigger. Something is just too painful to be witnessing, too painful to be recalling, and I start flashing back and I don't want to do that, so I dissociate. Sometimes I dissociate when somebody comes to the door unexpectedly. When I was living at home with my parents, it wasn't as bad because there were other people there. But when I'm alone in my own house, if somebody comes and knocks on the door, I'm not going to answer the door. I will hide. I will try to turn off lights if I think that the person outside won't notice. I fear what they have to offer at the door. A lot of times it's either the mailman who's just coming to put mail in my slot. It makes me freak out. It makes me freak out when like the garbage man will come and it makes lots of noises and sounds. So I will pretty much have a panic attack about it. I feel like I need to hide, and I will hide away from windows, down on the floor. I don't usually take showers when I'm home alone, just because I have this fear that if I'm taking a shower, somebody might break in and find me in a vulnerable state. Sometimes people will come home and I will be in the shower. If they don't make it known to me that they are here and I hear them, I go into a state of shock in the shower and I try to hide down in the like bathtub area of the shower. I've had previous history with problems where I have locked myself in a situation. So in my life now, I've just chosen to not lock doors other than my front door. I lock my front door. I lock all the like doors to the outside. But if I'm in a room, I won't lock the door and I leave the door open. So when I take a shower, I don't shut the door. I usually announce it. I'm going to take a shower. Please don't scare me. But it happens. Sometimes I get scared, and that's the horror movie, scream, bloody murder, fight for your life, and then I'm gone. I'm dissociative, and I have a very hard time coming back unless it's on my own. And it usually lasts for an hour, if that's the case. I hope that by talking about this, I can help somebody feel not so alone about it. Also, I feel like I can offer some more awareness about what dissociation is. At the moment, I can't really think of anything else that I could share with you. Again, it's all very painful to talk about, and I don't like it. So I have a hard time organizing my memories and organizing my thoughts to say this. So if I've prompted you to ask me any questions, feel free to talk to me about it. I'd love to hear from you. If you feel like you have post-traumatic stress disorder, I would love to be your friend on here on YouTube. Again, I haven't been able to join any small groups yet, and I'll keep you updated on the day I can and whether or not it goes well. For now, I'm just hanging out in my living room. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. Hi, YouTube. I wanted to talk about what it's like to be a kid. Oh, rude! Get down!